Ben's just going to present their check to West of England MS Therapy Centre because they weren't able to be at the meeting. So we can get a picture just to put on our website.
Of the what used to be called the MS Therapy Centre, but is now very well, if you didn't know. She's quite a very nice chief exec in Wheatfield Drive, you know?
Yeah, I know it is. I think Jenny James works there.
There's quite a few working in the office, aren't there?
So this planning meeting, huh? I've been told it's usually short, is it short? Finance is also short, too, so which one is the longest?
Leisure youth is generally the longest one. This varies. I mean, we act as consultees only, really, and to be perfectly honest with you, even if we put an objection through, 9 times out of 10, it'll be ignored by South Gloss and I'll give it the one anyway. So I chaired it for a couple of years, and I went through a planning enforcement where somebody built a roof extension. They got up into the roof and they built a massive dormer window, and we got enforcement on it. We stopped it, and we won the enforcement action. And then South Gloss turned around and said, well, if you just take a nip and a tuck here, we'll pass it for you. So a waste of time. So it's consultation only, really. So don't be surprised if we do ever object to anything, but it doesn't go through. But it's interesting to see what's happening in the town. Because in the town, in Bradley Stoke, a lot of, if you look through, you see things like this, PDR. It means permitted development rights.
Yes.
Tell me if I'm telling you something you already know. Because in most areas, there are developments that are permitted.
Yeah.
In Bradley Stoke, en masse, permitted development rights were revoked when the houses were built. So in general, there is no such thing as permitted development rights in 95% of Bradley Stoke.
Really?
So things that would normally go through on a PDR, on a permitted development right, will still usually come to council. It's not every property, but most of the builders revoked the permitted development rights.
Yeah.
So that's why you see things like PDR.
Yeah. And ADD?
Advert.
F.
Don't know. Probably full planning, I should imagine. But even things like this, depending on the size of them, a single story rear extension would have been, well, in fact, that one is a permitted development, this must be a larger one.
Yep.
Would generally have gone through. That's just from the last meeting, that's the decisions we made, tallied against the decisions. Well, actually, they did go, oh yeah, the oak tree. The tree preservation order.
This one with no comment made.
Yeah, I can't remember why. I really can't remember why no comment was made on it. And I was at a meeting. I mean, you can do that, it's not an issue. You don't have to comment on every application. Generally, if it's an application that involves the town council, we won't comment on it. If, for example, we're planning for the skate park and things like that, so we won't normally put a comment through on that.
Andrea, again, just
Andrea.
To see how things are going with the other signage the outside the
yeah. Sarah Confret.
And Sarah, yes.
Yes, Sarah Dr. Confret, because she's the councillor here now.
Yes,
I'm
yes,
no
I've yet congratulated her.
So,
but it was
sure
from last time I met.
Okay,
but well done. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
See you Christmas.
You're moving it around.
Yeah.
It doesn't do anything.
Thank you.
Bye.
It's up to you if you want to do it. I'm happy to do it.
No, I'm happy not to do it.
Okay,
the first year,
okay.
Well, I'll post it if you want to.
Okay, I'll start. First of all, I think we need to do it temporary.
Yep, so we need to elect a chair of the Planning and Environment Committee for 2019-20.
So,
I think Mike needs to be sitting down.
So, Mike.
Mike?
Mike?
Sorry, yes.
Michael.
That part of it which is not stomach is all ears.
So, are we planning to do the...
Well, you've got to do welcome introductions, emergency evacuation procedure.
And then election of the chair.
And you meant the fire alarm.
Thank you. I just... This is... I'm nobody. This is to start the meeting. Okay?
as a chair. Okay. I think it's a weather is really ugly, so I don't know if the fire was straight to the car park. Okay, the first one, election of chair of planning and environment committee for 2019-2020.
Can I nominate Brian?
Yeah, I second that. Fine. Yeah.
Can you with me one second?
I'll second that. All in favour?
Five even abstain.
Yeah.
Brian?
I could abstain, yes. Yeah. Against?
Favour.
Against? Abstention?
And
sure.
Did you abstain?
Yeah.
And Brian?
Okay. Thank you. Welcome, Chair. Okay, take home of the meeting and it's yours.
Okay.
Thank you.
Cheers. I understand we've got a quick meeting. We're only going in 10 minutes, but.
No, that's true. Well,
strange enough, I rang up earlier to give my apologies.
Hello, Chair.
I had another meeting to get to, but I decided to stay anyway. So.
I would like
to be quiet. Okay. First thing is submissions from the public. 15 minutes, we've got new members from the public. I can't see anybody there. I can point glasses, but moving on from that. Okay, to receive any apologies for absence.
Elaine Hardwick and Ed Rose.
Okay, if you note those. Okay, are there any declarations by members under Local Government Act 1972? If you don't know what that is, I'll get. Sharon, to explain what that is.
It's just if you have anything that relates to planning, like normally the South Gloss councillors will declare if they're on planning committee or licensing or anything like that, which might impact on.
Okay, well, I'm on a planning committee. I'm on South Gloss. I'm on DC. I'm DC.
Development control.
Development control, yeah.
Okay, then. Marvellous.
And sometimes, because it's now split into three areas, and sometimes there's several of the areas, so I've just been pulled in on another one. But if it's something which actually happens with this, then I will say it's a conflict and either get someone else to chair that particular meeting, or just basically refrain from siding with any kind of bit on that particular application.
Because obviously you can't be predetermined.
No, I generally, you won't generally find me actually doing that. Okay, so to agree terms of reference,
no,
I have no announcements from the chair other than what I just done.
Chair, okay. Do you want to mention about the community district is the next one, so do you want to please?
What, for the immediate?
Yeah,
it's not actually on this, is it?
Not in the list as an announcement by the chair. Just want to.
Well, we've got no one here to announce that to you. I think it was a I don't think we need to announce anything about that, because it's nothing to do with this, really.
As if the town council's one, the community festival is by the town council, under the auspices of the town council.
Well, yeah, but I mean, it's not on our agenda to talk about it. So,
yeah, it is not.
No, I mean, I could actually announce all sorts of things. That'd be excellent, but I'm not going to do that. No, but don't go there.
It's probably going to just announce it, take less time.
Okay, so there's going to be a town festival in a few days' time, which I think in fact starts the 5th, 6th, 7th,
7th, 7th, 7th, 7th, 7th, 7th, 7th, 7th, 7th, 7th, 7th,
7th, And I hope all the members of council will attend it. It should be very, it should be a good thing. And I hope the weather is going to be good.
It is going to be good, isn't it?
Good,
it's going to be really
it's
a
scorcher.
No, not this weekend, next weekend.
Oh, no.
We don't know that
far in advance. I have heard the sun is beginning to cool, though, so it could be a problem for us.
It is the official vote, we have to be pretty nice one, so let's see.
Okay. So, to agree terms of reference.
You have that in your agenda pack, have you got
them? Yep.
Staying here, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Vote on that, please.
Michael?
Sorry, do you like to?
I'll oppose it. Second it or
no, it's just to vote on it.
Just vote on it. Yeah, sorry, I'm sorry.
Thank you very much.
I'm struggling through my papers.
Yeah, I do that all the time. Luckily, I've got a secretary now.
They are theoretically in order, so you should literally just go.
Oh, but I have looked at them in the interim and probably
got them out. You took them out of order, all right.
I noticed that Hatchway is now actually labelling up all their items 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I went through them, and then there was like a 6A, 6B, 6C, 6B, and it was so funny because they were still in.
By the time we sort of got halfway through, they just made up that
work. So don't go there. Don't go there.
Change how I've done
the
things.
No, don't go there. Right, consider any matters arising from the minutes.
No,
confirm the minutes. Minutes. Right, that's what I'm doing. Confirm the minutes.
In order
of the meeting.
The numerical number.
Okay, of 24th of April as a correct record. And isn't there, so. Okay.
Anybody else? If nobody, I'll second it.
Okay.
Be difficult, weren't you?
Yeah.
Andy was there, Ben was there, Elaine Hart was there, Grimmel was there, Keith Crane was there, Byron Moore was there, so it's only Andy Ward which was there. Is that accepted? These minutes okay, Andy?
I'm happy to second
those.
So you're second? Yeah.
If that makes life easier.
Can we vote then, please? 1, 2, 3, 4 in favour?
Okay, considering matters rising from the minutes.
No,
there
aren't any.
Nothing? To note the outcome of previous planning applications and other documents pertaining to planning and environmental issues.
That was tabled tonight. There have been 15 previous planning decisions, 14 of which agreed with Bradford Stoke Town Council. The one that we didn't actually comment on was actually the first one tonight on the next agenda item, which is the erection of a single-storey rear extension to form additional living accommodation at 189 Jubilee Way. We did ask for an extension to the consultation time, and it was granted by the planning officer, but for some reason, today, the planning officer made the planning decision.
That's right.
Oh, right.
That doesn't happen very often. I could email him back and say why. But he hasn't got to me. So.
Sounds as though the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing.
I think sometimes they have so many planning applications, they have apologised in the past when they've made a bit of a mishap, because normally they're really good and we extend it until after our meetings. It's very rare. In fact, I don't think I've ever known them come back and say no, they won't extend it. They're really good at just supporting them.
That's very good. Very good of them.
We've got quite a good working relationship with them, which is good.
They've got a limited time to do a lot of the applications in, so if they had already delayed that one by quite a lot.
Yeah, because it was quite an early one, I think.
That might have been a problem for them.
But as I say, the planning officer did say yes.
Various responses from appropriate authorities regarding the planning applications relating to Brown Stoke.
And you have the updated document tabled, so there's just two. This is the MS Therapy Centre. So this is what the sign is that they're proposing to put up. So as Dora was saying earlier, it will be referred to as the Brightwell. And I'll show you the street image where it's going to be. Going to be on there, so you can see
that's great.
That's where it is, and that's where it's going to be on that bit there.
That's fine. I propose
second that.
That's no objection.
No, it's far enough back from the road, it's not going to distract drivers or anything.
No, it's sustainable. There is a comment actually from this website from Sustainable Transport.
It's quite tiny actually. Single story rear extension to form additional living accommodation at 37 Bracken Green.
Okay.
People who back on to it, any comment?
No, there's no comments on the website at all. So that is what's there at the moment.
Just slightly larger than what's already there.
So that's the existing floor plan at the moment, and it's obviously the rear elevation here.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's just going across.
That's really nice.
That's right.
Hmm. More aesthetically pleasing as well.
Okay, if it's not creating any parking problems, I know they used to object. And otherwise, people coming from the other side, you know. So this is fine. I'm happy to propose it unless there is something else. I don't want to propose to the planning commission at the same time.
You can, though. Any proposed? You got second?
I second it.
That's an objection. Can we vote, please? Thank you very much.
I would say that the government has now actually altered the rules yet again, so that the temporary ability for people to get the planning permission, well, automatically, we can't be refused, permissions can't be refused for some extensions, is now being recorded.
And what is the limit? What's the actual physical limit?
4 meters.
4 meters.
And 6 meters for detached houses. So it's 4 meters for semis. I think that was a detached one anyway. So for detached, when it was 6 meters.
And is that just for a single story or?
Rear extension, complete.
What, double story.
Okay, to deal with matters referring to work within the scope of the Planning and Environment Committee not covered elsewhere. So, 1 Curbs Patrick Metro Bus Extension, 60 Patch Lane, Stakeholder Liaison Group Updates.
You have that in your agenda pack. Meeting that I went to on the 30th of April. This shows you how things are progressing. We have South Gloucester now, they're providing an update. We've got a page on our website which is specifically for the work. So we then send the update through to our website so that, and then the link through to the South Gloucester website as well so that members of the public can get up to date information. The Ditch Patch Lane bridge will be shut from next, I think it's on Sunday it starts for 4 weeks. That's while BT do their work. I know there's been a lot of comment on social media about that the councillor have got it wrong again, but it's nothing to do with the council, it's actually BT. You have to do diversion works of underground cables before they can actually start the proper build. I think South Gloucester are going to use it essentially as a sort of trial to see how the diversionary routes work.
Mm-hmm.
So time will tell on that one.
Presumably they're going to have to drop the road surface because I'm sure Network Rail won't be happy to have the bridge raised
the
after
bridge isn't, no, the bridge isn't going any higher. They're actually
diving and cutting away.
Cutting underneath. There's a lot of scepticism about whether, about how
water.
It will be a really steep, but
water,
South Gloucester
water blocking?
No, they'll put adequate drainage in. They said that was all addressed.
And we had one bridge, not where I was, 5-6 miles away, where the railway went over and it actually went down like that, you can guarantee if you had a thunderstorm it would flood.
Mm.
You know, I am going back 30 years admittedly, but it's a worry.
Again, it is one of those
worry.
Times will tell.
Yeah, that's sure, because even right now, if you go on during the rain time, it will be flooded over there, so you can get a splash.
But I mean, they're doing a major build and not just doing a big dam, so I'm hoping that they'll address all the drainage and everything while they're doing that.
Needs to be got right first time, of course.
Yeah, I'm sure it will.
Can't afford go back.
Just from out of interest, on the A38, where you've got the cut through near the railway bridge, in case it actually goes under, so it's quite deep there on the A38. You have actually
rains in that area, sometimes it does get flooded if the pumps don't work. Because obviously they're not going to put the pumps on until they get flooded in the first place.
Well, yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, but they
would. They should be sensitive, they
should
be sensitive, shouldn't
they? Should be doing things
if
like
that's
that.
The point
yeah.
of them.
Yeah.
So they do, this on your pack that you've got there, the red route is the route that they will be saying as a diversion. They do actually have an alternative southern option. But for the 4 week that it's closed in June, they are just publicising the red route and they'll see how that works. And if it causes absolute carnage, I guess they might look at putting on the blue route for when the next...
Realistically, people who live in the area will make their own mind up about which is the best way to go.
And
the diversion
yeah.
route really is only for strangers.
South Gloss have acknowledged that, they said, because obviously there were all sorts of talks about, well, people are just going to use cut-throughs, but there isn't much they can do about that, short of closing all the roads, which obviously would have a negative impact on everybody who lives in the area.
And what's the harm in them using cut-throughs if they're available? At least it means... You know, doesn't cause a huge problem. Might be a bit irritating for the people who live on those roads for a short while, but
it's going to be two years. So you're looking at a long time.
Yeah. Well, it'd be even worse if they closed all the roads and just had sort of complete, no traffic on them. It would impact the actual people who live there anyway. So.
So Crossfish have talked about lots of things, but the reality is it's very, very difficult to stop people using shortcuts. There's been quite a lot of talk about it coming up just on this road here. Because people will go down so far and decide, I'll just go through and I think, well, do I really want to go all the way around that way? Or do I want to take this cut?
Mm.
The problem is for any commuters, if they're doing it at peak times, because this road gets blocked up anyway at peak times.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter which route you come into, it's going to be blocked up at the top end. It's just going to be difficult. People are going to be having to plan their routes quite well in advance. You may well find people from Winterbourne and things may not actually come down the route at all. You may go up further.
Yeah, may have
and
a
come down to
A38
and avoid driving Stoke. even Stoke. Gifford, Little Stoke are very concerned about Little Stoke Lane and the schools. There are a lot of schools there, and those roads are not really designed, they're not as big as these roads. Because you've got houses fronting the driveway straight onto the roads, which you haven't got here. You've got the cul-de-sacs leading off of those roads, which makes it a little bit safer for people. So, Little Stoke Lane and Stoke Lane, they've already got a consultation up already to reduce the speed of the road to 20 miles an hour and actually put in some more speed tables. So that will then mean that people going up those roads, once they find the shortcut routes, if it's 20 mile an hour limit and the police can enforce it and you've also got speed tables, people are going to be more inclined not to go up that road. That's what people their hope. So, but they've been trying to get 20 mile an hour limit on that road for a long time, so for some people this is a blessing because at least they're getting their road reduced in speed already, but it's not good. It's going to be a nightmare for a couple of years, and then when it all is finished, hopefully people will be able to enjoy a quicker access to where they need to get to without all this hassle.
Because, mainly areas, as it's a gypsy patch lane, people coming through from sometimes from the school or from the university of the pasture, another route is to eat, commuting to eat. Winterbourne and places like that.
Yeah.
And then big traffic flow through that road. So it's actually will cause some difficulties to many people. One of the things here they mentioned is parking. They will work with the local employees to encourage considerate commuting. So are the council providing any help for these employers or any ideas of sharing?
They're working with the main the businesses.
Like Rolls Royce,
and also people from various other businesses that have lots of people, and they are actually using it. I know Rolls Royce are using it as a way to promote shared car use and that sort of thing, to actually get into their workforce and say, look, this is happening,
there's lots of other ways you could possibly consider getting to work. How about this? How about that? So they're actually using it as a sort of, not an education, but something.
And also, what about the cycle to work scheme? Because that, you know, the government cycle to work scheme, that might encourage people to use that, and then that's going to have an impact on the planet as well.
Yeah, they have been involved with the Sustrans people, obviously.
And some of our people got to come across.
One more thing, what about the pedestrian nexus? This is actually about whether there will be a pedestrian nexus from that point.
They're hoping that during the 4 weeks, this 4 week closure, there will still be able to be pedestrian and cycle wheeling, not cycle riding,
yeah,
but wheeling or cycle
yeah.
through.
Yeah.
They're hoping that they obviously, until work starts for the major bit, they don't know, they can't guarantee that that will be open access. But I know that they're looking at putting on some form of shuttle buses for people, like residents or people who need to walk between the two. And I think they're doing some work on the, is it the bridge over Patchway Station as well? There's
yes,
bridge.
They are.
So
I went by train through there today.
Oh, right.
The bridge work is going on.
Yeah.
Exactly what, I don't know, but something was bridge work.
So yeah, they are trying to address all these concerns. They are aware of all of them. So the next meeting is Thursday the 6th of June, so the Town Council can send one representative. So I have been to the past couple, but I don't know whether the Chair of Planning wants to go instead of me, or...
No, you can carry on. You might have seen me there anyway, but you can carry on.
And then I'm
going
to report back to planning.
What time is it?
Well, there's only one representative to go,
yeah,
so
what time?
10 till 12.
Oh, no. Anyway, there was at that time I'd been invited for all the people's forum.
No, I think it's pretty good that you're going in that.
Thank you.
And then I'll just report back to this committee and put this up on my website. So just try to keep people
the thing is,
that,
I mean, it really impacted the Stoke, and the price is so different, usually. But the same token, you know, we are going to be taking the brunt of quite a lot of this
traffic
there.
Yeah.
So they just say you can just throw it at us, but just wait and see what happens. But.
I think it's quite positive that they are acknowledging that there's been problems. They're not saying everything's going to be hunky dory.
There's been about all sorts of things,
so
actually.
You know, and I mean, this has been a good couple of years in the plan, so it's not that like they've just suddenly said, oh, I know, let's just shut up. This is a good few years down the line, and this is a longer term work. And they knew the bridge needed replacing to enable more vehicles to be able to get underneath it.
But a few people have spoken to me about Brookway last year, but I reckon we're concerned that they're going to be coming out to use your next step.
Just have to see how it goes, won't we?
I'm probably very pleased that South Gloucestershire is playing ball, because there's one council in Wiltshire which has refused permission to have a bridge altered because they say it's a listed building. And I guess it's causing havoc because of the overhead wires.
This has been in the planning process for a long time. I was part of the committee which agreed to the permission on this, but we put all sorts of conditions on it. And one was to actually make sure that we actually have quite a strict understanding with South Gloucestershire that they put the signs in at a very early stage to take them down Bradley Stoke Way, not to allow them down as far as here, and also, you know, to divert any other traffic into other areas like the MOD and everything, because again, some people sort of come down, well, not the MOD necessarily, but Filton or whatever, and try and divert them around in a different manner. So you know, that has been part and parcel of it, but it's not a very good thing. And for people who've got businesses actually in Gypsy Patch Lane on the other side by the road, by the works there, there's all sorts of tire companies, etc., etc. To actually literally shut those businesses down was absolutely ridiculous, because that was almost what was going to be happening. So they're supposed to be now making sure that there are routes always open for those people at normal business times, so that they get their vehicles in and out, and also other times to put their goods in. Into there, and have really good signage to make sure that people understand how to get there, and that they, you know, although it might look closed, it's open. So there's supposed to be big signs coming up saying these businesses are still open, and for what you've said, well, hopefully that will all happen, because otherwise those people will lose huge amounts of money.
Absolutely.
in a 2 year, like, he reckoned it's going to be 2 years, but knowing everybody else, well, 18 months, I think it was, wasn't it?
I think, yeah, I think so. It's probably 14 months for a total closure.
Yeah, so, and then extra time for the other side.
Yeah, it's
okay, all right, biodiversity initiative, wildflowers, insects and road verges.
We've had a letter from the biodiversity officer in South Wales Council. Asking whether we could identify, whether they're asking all parish and towns councils to identify areas of grass verges which could be left for wildflowers. Actually, in Bradley Stoke, if you think about it, have quite a lot of wildflower areas already. I mean, the verges that they've done on Brookway, they look brilliant.
Beautiful.
At the moment. And I mean, I think they did that as a pilot scheme last year to see if it would work. So I think this is what they've done there is what they would like to introduce in other areas of South Gloucestershire. We've also got the Nature Reserve and Common East as well.
But then they mentioned about knowing the verges and that's something.
Well, that's what they want people to identify areas that could be left to grow long. I did speak to John, premises manager, who oversees the grass verges strategic very stringently, and I said, is there any way you think? And he said, no, because they do look a mess if they're left to grow long. And that's suitable in some areas, but not others.
I couldn't quite work it out. I'm not really into the plants and things like that, but I can't understand what benefit you would take. If you're going to cut it anyway in the end, what's the benefit?
Well, I think because if you look at what they've done on Brook Way, I don't know whether you saw them when they were actually doing them.
Yeah.
So they dig the area and then they plant wildflower seeds. They don't just leave it to go to rack and ruin. They actually manage it as like a wildflower area.
I can get that part.
So
where it's saying mow the verges less often, I can't understand if they're going to mow it at all. I can understand if they don't mow it, but if they just leave it to be like a David Attenborough, you know, sort of area that is wild and anything, I can understand that part. But if you are going to mow it anyway, I just can't quite understand what's the benefit of leaving it longer.
So we pay for those, and if we were to adopt the ethos of let's have it, we could cut 10 mows and have one mow a year.
It would make the town look very messy.
It would.
But they're not saying about it. I mean, I know they're saying the sort of consequences also financial, but that's not where they're coming from. They're saying from the point of view of the, you know,
but the habitat this provides is essential to the insect population, which is what it's all there for.
I think Ben's absolutely right. The key word in this whole thing is biodiversity.
Yeah, it's the habitat.
And we read in the papers that this type of bird or that type of insect is going to vanish in this country in 15 years, 20 years down the road.
But
anything
is it not
we can
going
do
to
help them must surely be good.
Which I think is why we're really lucky in Bradley, that we do have so many of these areas already, whereas obviously in a lot of towns and parishes they don't.
If you think about the Bradley Sick and Doom group, where they've tried their beehives and things like that, all this stuff is all very good for honeybees and all those insects we depend upon in our food chain, which is why they really tried to push it. I mean, I get the idea that it's a mess, and I wouldn't want the whole of Bradley Stoke Way to be as, do you know what I mean, at all. With grass, but if we could have places, and we're very lucky with the nature reserve in the middle, but the nature reserve in the middle does have a lot of just wild
grass. I completely get all of that, you know, and
really
I'm for it if I can understand.
It's ecology and it's the biodiversity, which is what is the winning factor of this argument.
I think what I'm saying in this paragraph here is that whilst they're flowering, pollination. So not necessarily leave it permanent to go to seed, but whilst they're in flower. For the insects to then go and pollinate. So once the flowers are dead, then the insects won't be looking to pollinate. That's what it's
And then the insects move on somewhere else then?
To live flowers. So leave it alone for a period, it's flowering, the insects go in, the insects then pollinate, then move on when it dies off. So that's what they're saying in that paragraph there.
Yeah, and it's quite right. I mean, the reality is, if you are a farmer, for instance, okay, and you maintain your hedgerows, which you get paid for by grants which come back in from the EU and stuff, other people.
Yeah, start that all over again.
But the reality of the matter is, you are told not to cut until a particular point in time. So in other words, you cut once and then you leave it, because you've got nesting birds, you've got all sorts of things which you can damage. So there is a time when you can cut, but after that particular point, you're not allowed to. So there's a little window opportunity to do that. So what you'll do if you go down lots of country lanes, you'll see at some points everything's cut back very severely, and other times, you know, you've got these massive hedgerows and blackberry bushes and everything, and it's all cut back again. And this is
I understand what they're trying to say, but I just can't quite get the point of it if they're going to be cut anyway, because if the insects are going to be living anyway, I just can't understand.
Well, I mean,
I think it's the pollinators as much as anything, so I guess it's the bees and that sort of thing which would obviously pollinate and then move off, as Andy said.
Yeah.
I think Councillor Terry Oakley also is what's resonating is she would like to have all these things happening in the nature reserve and things like that, not in the highway villages. Okay. Highway villages, I noticed that recently, because I think as we know, when I was chair of the planning earlier, we started doing that. We were doing a good job in cleaning and cutting. A few weeks it was actually a little bit messy on this
side. Yeah, we are aware of that. John is aware of that.
Yes.
I think they're due to be cut this week.
Yes.
It's just the fact there's been such a huge growing spurt.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's true. And I think I agree with the content of that, but not in the nature reserve and other places. But we would like to keep our town meeting.
Yeah.
So that side, highway villages, we need to keep it. Other parts, yeah, we can keep it. Because hedges there, we have a lot of hedges.
Yeah.
Protected hedges.
Lots of hedgerows, aren't there, in the town? Yeah.
Have we had anybody identify, like John Redwell, identify areas which we could save money on? And
he said nowhere.
So he's not happy about it?
No.
Okay, that's fine.
Because we have so many areas. If we didn't have areas like we do already, then obviously we'd have to do it. But the fact that we're very blessed with
the nature.
So we're happy,
the nature
we're happy with Broadway.
Yeah.
They were going to do something down Bradstoke Way, I think, at one point. Because we bumped into them. Like daffodils and all sorts of things.
And they've got trees down there, haven't
they? Well, Bradstoke Way, as you come up from Tesco to Westwood, I think it's called, on the left, it's absolutely overgrown.
Yeah,
yeah.
That's left.
Yeah, supposed to be like that. Oh, is it?
Yeah.
And that, is that ever going to get mown?
No, because that...
Have they put any flowers
that,
in there at all or not?
I don't know.
That was a deliberate decision to leave that.
Yeah.
Well, there you are. That's a massive area then, isn't it?
So I think we can actually designate that as a wildlife one.
So we're not going to ask them to put any wildlife flowers along there and make it a bit better?
No, that side, I would like to have it. What about the beautiful...
You mean the bit up where it goes up behind the trees, that bit, on that slope?
Yeah.
Which is already left. Because, that's the one that South Gloss cut, we just drew behind it.
Well, if they just left it, I mean, it might be a good idea to actually at least make it look a bit more decorative.
What, to put some of those wild ones in?
Well, I would think so, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's a perfect place, isn't it? If the decision has already been made to leave it.
Yeah.
I think supporting that as an initiative, I was doing that, strictly as a token, as a symbol of our support for our town for this initiative.
It's nice seeing this here as a report. There was a request. Well, I've had another area, someone's found it, there's a green area outside of their house which is just basically ragged with earth, and people just continuously dump things there, and goodness knows what else. So they've asked permission to actually plant some more flowers, which is quite interesting. So, sort of sent it on to South Gloucestershire to help and see if they can actually help sort it out. Because the people that own the ground there, in the housing association.
And for the people,
but we think people could change that.
Mm-hmm.
I think we'd rather look out on that, you know, even if it's even grows a bit, but with flowers in it, than rubbish.
Chair, the people who send this letter will be happy seeing that we are supporting them as a token. So.
And when I reply, I will point out the areas that we've already got that have got the wall.
Yeah.
I think that would be
so. So, Tom, did you post that?
Yeah.
Second.
All those in favour of going back and asking South Gloucester? Thank you very much. Well done. It's funny to see this here tonight, sort of came down the road with this glorious, you know, there was a few patches which weren't as glorious as ever as well.
Yeah.
How was
your
beautiful project going on?
Unfortunately, it only looked really good for a couple of weeks. In between that time,
well,
it's very
just
sporadic,
just
and then after that,
just
you think,
just
need to cut in. But yeah,
like,
yeah,
hey. I've sent horses around, he might eat it or something.
Sharon, do you know the beautification project for the roundabout? How is that going?
There's a hell of a lot of paperwork that has to be completed from South Gloss excuse me, and so we are, that is still is in the process.
We get there.
It's a Chapter 8 training that Ambience had to undertake, and they did the training, and then they have to wait 6 to 8 weeks for their training cards to come through, and South Gloss can't have just an acknowledgement that they've done the training, and they have to see if the training did. So we have to wait that
process.
I guess it's because they're going to be working in the living room.
I'm going to ask actually about the you know, the roundabouts that you see, and you know, the bottom where it's supposed to be a kind of a guide. The chevron.
Which roundabout is this one?
All of them. Most of them.
Okay. Yeah,
they're all absolutely completely covered in mud and all that sort of thing, so it's not really easy to detect that there is a chevron there. So I just wondered if
that's painted.
I know, it just needs to be jet washed or something.
Yeah.
It's painted brick.
Isn't it?
So jet wash it would blow it off.
Mm.
Along with the mud.
Yeah, if you get you down there painting it.
Jet wash it.
One of the best things for that would be is to go on Fix My Street and take photographs of those roundabouts and post them, because then South Gloss would have also a public request.
Street care, isn't it? Yeah.
It's quite
street,
a bit,
but I find South Gloucestershire Council are far more responsive when they've got something on street care and there's a little pinpoint on a public
map. They like a pinpoint on a map.
Oh yeah, I love a pinpoint on a map, and I get a response, and I've got so many things just done just by using Fix My Street.
Yeah, I love it.
If you go on the South Gloss website, they have this report it section, and there's masses of stuff that you can report. It's really good.
Sneaks.
But I definitely recommend the Fix My Street app, because it's a third-party independent thing, and they keep the record there until you, as the member of the public, verify that your complaint was fixed or does something else done. And if you've got an iPhone or...
But I think that South Gloss will tell you that they don't monitor the Fix My Street app.
So they don't monitor it, but what they do is they get the formal complaint email onto their queue. So they give you a customer reference number and they give you all those things. So they monitor it internally.
All right, but they don't...
But
go on,
it's the external tools spawns all of that stuff for you. And then you end up with this public record of like, hey, look how bad the local authority's doing, or look how good the local authority's doing. And you can get quite a lot of things done.
Right.
So that would be a good candidate for that.
Yeah, wouldn't they expect me as a councillor though to go to them first?
No.
You're a resident of the town?
No, I understand that, but I'm also a councillor, so, you know.
You can do it both.
I know, but wouldn't they take a dim view of me coming directly?
No, not at all. Because
I think they would class it as a councillor as being proactive.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, good, okay.
And one more thing, also regarding the parking, as you mentioned, there is actually also a Facebook or thing which, if you post it, immediately the response would be better.
Mm. I get quite a lot of responses on that on Fixed Street. I actually get it, they actually sent to me. so as well.
Oh,
you
really?
Know, yeah, because it's basically set up like that, I think, so that in the local district council.
So it's Fix Your Street.
Fix My Street.
Yeah.
And South Gloucestershire Report.
And I can always follow that.
Oh, okay,
which,
great.
You know, all the district
yeah.
councils of that area can follow that.
Yeah.
But I will pass it on to, I'll get John when Jason's out around the town to go and have a look at the chevrons on the roundabouts
yeah.
and take some photos, and we can send that off to Street there as well. So
other than that, I think you can just basically work with Sharon and just send her a little
yeah.
email and she'll sort it out.
But I mean, what we do is, but we, you say, and Brian says I'll sort it out. My way of sorting it out is I send it to South Gloss.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, yeah, of course
you
do.
So, yeah.
But that's what you do. So.
But the more reports that South Gloss get of a specific
yeah.
problem, the better, really.
Yeah, of course.
So,
yeah.
yeah.
Could you just answer a question for me as well? There's a, just as you come into my road,